Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents How to Read the Bible by Harvey Cox, narrated by Jim Denison. Introduction. I did not grow up in the Bible Belt. My parents were only occasional churchgoers. I never saw either one of them pick up a Bible, let alone read it. Nonetheless, I was born, as many of us were, in a Bible-drenched country. Take, for example, the movies I went to on Saturday afternoons, King of Kings, The Robe, and of course, the Ten Commandments, among many others. The one that sticks in my mind most was Samson and Delilah, featuring Victor Mature and Hedy Lamarr, which suffused the biblical epic with an erotic quality sure to stir the glands of an adolescent boy. But I also knew the Bible was serious stuff. It was the volume witnesses placed their hand on to swear an oath. Soldiers reported they had been saved from death by the New Testament they carried in their breast pocket. In Protestant America, with its historic aversion to idols, the Bible was the only universally recognized sacred icon. In a sense, the whole of America was a Bible Belt, although how much people knew about what was in the Bible was another matter. At some point, I did discover that there was, in fact, a Bible, a large one, in our home. Covered with dust, it lay at the bottom of a set of shelves containing several volumes of the old brown and gold-bound Collier's Encyclopedia. No one ever opened the Bible, or as far as I can remember, the encyclopedia either. But one day, driven by curiosity rather than piety, I looked inside the Bible. It contained some colorful pictures of people who appeared to be wearing bathrobes and towels. Gold margins bordered the first chapters of some of the books, but looking through it, I soon discovered that for our family, its main function was to serve as an archive for the dates of births, marriages, and deaths of previous generations, inscribed in different colored ink, some of it now fading, in a section just before the book of Genesis. I think of my personal history with the Bible as unfolding in three stages, each with its own way of reading it. The first stage I call the narrative stage. Like many people, I simply took the Bible at face value and more or less literally, even though as a youngster I had my doubts about some of the accounts that seemed improbable. The second phase of my evolving understanding of the Bible might be called the historical one. It began when I was in college and continued through seminary and beyond. In this period, my emphasis was on the context in which a particular biblical book was written, for and to whom, when, and why. The third stage, which has been developing slowly during my adult years, I would like to call the spiritual stage. I do not, however, mean spiritual in a narrow or merely inward sense, but in a holistic one that includes inner and outer, personal and social. I will have more to say about all these modes in the rest of this book. In retrospect, I do not believe these three stages, the narrative, the historical, the spiritual, or the manner of studying the Bible each implies, can be sharply differentiated. Just as we all carry features of earlier stages in our psychological development with us as we grow older, all of these ways of grasping the Bible remain part of my repertoire. But I believe they need to supplement and complement each other in order to get the most from any reading of biblical texts. This is something I attempt to do throughout this book. The narrative stage. As a child, along with my siblings, I was dutifully dispatched to the Baptist Sunday school next door to our home by my religiously indifferent parents, in part to keep up appearances, but also, I suspect, to get us out of the house so they could savor a second cup of coffee and peruse the Philadelphia Inquirer. Seated in Sunday school on hard wooden chairs under the tutelage of a series of well-intentioned but only sketchily informed lay teachers, I heard the stories of the Bible. I found them fascinating, if frequently not quite credible. there was the nasty fight between Cain and Abel, and there was the aforementioned Delilah, who entrapped a muscular Samson with her sultry charms. There was Noah and his menagerie aboard the ark. I especially liked the one about David, the cheeky little kid who slew the big bully. And there were also all those stories Jesus told, the parables, and the ones people told about him. We did not just hear these stories. We also sometimes acted them out. As a child, I often pulled on a bathrobe, wrapped a towel around my head, and gripped a stick in my hand as a character in a nativity play. We have seen a star in the east. When, as a teenager, I began to attend church, mostly to sing in the choir, I always noticed the huge black leather Bible that lay open on the varnished pulpit, its gold edges glistening and its purple page marker dangling. It was the biggest book I had ever seen, so I knew it must be important. Sometimes the preacher read from it, but more often he read from a much smaller one placed on top of the big one. What little I remember about the sermons I heard from that pulpit is that they were made up mainly of anecdotes and allegories intended to illustrate the points the preacher was making. Years later, I still remember many of these illustrations, but hardly any of the points they were supposed to dramatize. For a kid in a church that had no formal creeds, the Bible was not a handbook of doctrines. It was a compendium of stories. And for that, I am grateful. Those were the days before the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that the practice of reading the Bible in public schools was unconstitutional. Consequently, I heard the Bible read every day for years. At that time, state law mandated that 10 verses of the Bible be read aloud, but without commentary, so that is exactly what our teachers, and later the students selected for the task, did. What we heard 90% of the time were Psalms from the King James Version. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Psalm 24, verse 9. I liked the cadence of the words, but what king was entering and where those gates were never explained. Still, it is remarkable how, after so many years, those verses still resonate through my synapses. If at Sunday school I encountered the Bible mainly as stories, in the public school it spoke to me primarily as poetry. In my teens, I became more involved with our small church, was elected president of the youth group, and as such was even invited to preach once when the pastor, along with nearly everyone else in the congregation, was on vacation. As a high school student, and as I began to read the Bible on my own, I began to realize that, as endearing as the stories I was learning were, they represented only a carefully culled sample drawn from many more, some of them apparently deemed not suitable for Sunday school, such as the ones about Noah's drunken nakedness or the prostitute who concealed Joshua's spies. It also occurred to me that the lay people who taught us had no inkling, and maybe no curiosity, about when and why any of these stories were first told. In short, the story stage of my introduction to the Bible was also largely a literal stage. When I went to college, I majored in history, but took a couple of religion courses, neither of them on the Bible. I was not, however, unexposed to the Bible during my undergraduate years. A conservative Christian organization called the InterVarsity Christian Fellowship sponsored student-led Bible studies in different campus buildings and sometimes in dormitory rooms where some of the students crouched on the bed or the floor. At first, I found these sessions intriguing and attended several of them. But I soon noticed that the questions I raised were often treated with smiling dismissiveness by the student leaders. For them, the kinds of queries we were taught to ask in our history classes, like the dating of a document or the trustworthiness of a source, were just not appropriate. Inquiries about when a given book of the Bible was written or for whom it was originally intended were politely ruled out. We were supposed to focus exclusively on what God was saying to us now in a particular passage. I tried, but I eventually lost interest, not in the Bible, which continued to fascinate me, but in the way it was approached, at least in these Bible study groups. I have always been grateful that through my childhood exposure to the Bible, I learned to regard it as a compilation of stories. True, this was a way of thinking that was innocent and unsophisticated, but it also taught me to appreciate the Bible as basically an anthology of different kinds of narratives, letters, and poetry, not as a handbook of doctrines I was expected to subscribe to. I continue to believe what this narrative approach gave me is a good foundation on which to build a more adult way of understanding it. But it only goes so far. Once I was introduced to the pleasure and the discipline of studying history in college, I could not be happy with the constraints of the dorm Bible study. I was looking for something more. Then, in seminary, although it was not an easy step for me, I gradually came to see that studying the Bible historically is not something foreign we force on it. I began to appreciate the Bible as a gift that comes to us from and through history, and that a more than superficial reading of it demands we approach it, at least in part, from a historical perspective. The historical stage. When I graduated from college, I was undecided at first whether to begin doctoral studies in order to pursue my deepening interest in history or to enroll in seminary, learn more about religion and the Bible, and maybe become a minister. In the end, I decided on seminary. That was where my next take on the Bible began. My professors called it the historical critical method. What it amounted to was an attempt to apply the methods then current in scientific historical studies to the text of the Bible. Without knowing the terminology, I saw that this might well be what I had been looking for, given the questions I was discouraged from raising in the dorm Bible study. Still, when I found myself suddenly confronted by such a radically different way of viewing the Bible, it came as a rude shock. Even though I was an adult by then, my attitude toward the Bible when I first arrived at seminary was a bit naive and what might now be called pre-critical. Suddenly, I heard about the multiple sources of the Pentateuch, the priority of the Gospel of Mark, and the question of how many of the Pauline letters Paul himself really wrote. I will return to some of these matters later in my discussions of the biblical books, but I want to recall here that although the new knowledge I was acquiring was often exciting, it also troubled me. I was in no sense a fundamentalist, but I wondered how or even whether this historical critical vivisection of the Bible could be reconciled to the personal importance it had come to have for me. It was not an easy time. Still, in the end, it was worth it, and it has made me deeply sympathetic toward people who are going through the same difficult transition. Another purpose of this book is to help them negotiate it. Study tip. There are now numerous online Bible commentaries on books of the Bible that take current research into consideration. There are just as many that either reject or ignore it. Among the former, some are designed for preachers and theological students, others for thoughtful non-specialists. Consequently, one must be careful in choosing. Here are three from the former category I consider reliable. The International Critical Commentary is now available online through Logos. It is creatively arranged to allow readers to check different translations and compare interpretations. Bible Gateway lists authors and commentators to choose from if readers would like to compare and contrast different commentaries. Hermeneia is perhaps the most prestigious commentary. It includes English translations of recent articles in French and German. It may at times be a stretch for non-specialists, but a stretch well worth taking. The spiritual stage. Just as I had found the literal story stage not enough as I got older, I began to see that the historical approach, although important, was also not enough either. Then came the next transition in my take on the Bible. It began in September 1963 and is still continuing. That month, I was arrested along with 40 other civil rights demonstrators, 30 of them young black kids and a few of their parents, in a small city in the American South. We were apprehended for taking part in a peaceful protest march organized by the local chapter of Martin Luther King's Southern Christian Leadership Conference. Inside the jail, once we were photographed and fingerprinted and had surrendered our wallets and belts, the warden separated the white protesters from the black ones. But those of us in the white cell block could hear the young black prisoners singing. Sometimes we sang back in response, if not quite as lustily. On the Saturday after we were incarcerated, the warden, a mild-mannered, middle-aged white man, paused in front of our cell. "Well," he smiled, scratching his head, "them colored kids been asking for a Bible, so they can have Sunday school and church tomorrow." Still smiling, he shook his head. "So I gave 'em one," he said. "Can't do no harm, I guess." No harm, I thought. What the warden clearly did not know was that the reason these youngsters were in his jail was that they had been listening to Dr. King and some of his co-workers teach and preach from that harmless Bible. They had learned that they were children of the same God who created white people and that they had an equal right to dignity and equality. The warden did not realize that, from Exodus to the Gospels to Revelation, the Bible talks about freedom and has stoked more than one revolutionary movement in history. Sure enough, on Sunday morning, the black adolescents had church. They alternated preaching, mainly from Exodus, praying and singing. I wish I could have joined them, but as I sat on my narrow cot in the cell, listening from down the hall, "Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land, tell old Pharaoh, let my people go," I realized that for those kids, the Bible was more than a collection of beguiling stories from long ago, and also much more than a quasi-historical document to be parsed, analyzed, dated, and classified. They had never heard about any historical critical method. For them, the Bible was a summons to be all they were meant to be. It was a living link to the long history of liberation movements, of which theirs was only the most recent. And it was a powerful assurance that, as Dr. King had told them, history was on their side, and somehow, one day, they would overcome. It was not just a story, it was their story. They read it in the full-orbed, holistic way I have termed spiritual. After I was released on bail and got back home, I thought again about the dusty Bible on the bottom shelf in our living room with its fading birth and death inscriptions, and I thought about the big Bible on the pulpit in church. I thought about the Bible as stories, and I thought about the classes I had taken on the historical critical method. I did not regret either phase of my encounter with the Bible. It is, after all, in large part, a collection of narratives, as the current idiom has it. It is also a patchwork of documents by many writers that has come down to us through a complicated historical process. It did not drop out of the sky, and we need to know about that process. But what I learned in the jail cell is that the Bible is something much more. It is an invitation, a living record of an open-ended history of which we can have a part. It is a still, unfinished story. What does my personal growing up with the Bible have to do with the question implied by the title of this book? How do we read it today? And perhaps more pointedly, why should we read it today? We live in what has been called a secular age. But reading and studying the Bible has obviously not disappeared. If anything, more of it than ever seems to be going on. Year after year, the Bible remains the leading global bestseller. Why does this bulky mosaic of ancient Hebrew and Greek legends, prophecies, poetry, parables, letters, and visions continue to fly off the shelves and into shopping carts? In an age of breakthroughs in brain science, electronic telescopes, cloning, and CAT scans, why is this disparate amalgam of pre-scientific writings still translated into new languages every year? 392 languages and dialects so far, and counting. One answer, of course, is that perhaps our age is not as secular as some people think. God, despite premature eulogies, seems not to have died after all. The dramatic resurfacing of gods and goddesses, to say nothing of angels, vampires, and apparitions, and not the death of God or the withering away of religion, has become the hallmark, for blessing or for bane, of the early 21st century. Yet something has undoubtedly changed in the global culture of spirituality. Are we denizens of this 21st century becoming more secular, but still carrying with us traces of our previous religiousness? Are we more religious, less religious, or, more likely, religious in a new way? Is it possible that the whole secular-religious dichotomy is woefully deficient? I am in many ways a thoroughly secular person, and also in many ways a religious one. But I do not find these two identities totally at odds. They overlap, interact, and blend into each other. As a secular man, I am nonetheless shaped and informed by a religious tradition I see no reason to shed, even when I find myself disagreeing with many of its elements. As a religious person, I still thrive on living in whatever is meant by the secular age, with its celebration of democracy, human rights, and relishing life in this world rather than hankering for the next. Furthermore, I am not alone. That is who most of us are, or are becoming. The dominant ethos of the 21st century consists of an intermingling of the sacred and the secular. Some are calling it post-secular. But then, there is the Bible. What can we make of its stubborn persistence in this new secular religious age? Large numbers of people not only buy the Bible, many continue to read and study it. Thousands of Bible study groups meet regularly in America today. Some huddle in church basements, some in homes, and others in dorm rooms, prisons, and offices. It has been reported that Bible study groups meet in the Pentagon and in the cubicles of Goldman Sachs. For those who participate, these groups obviously have a real value. They often combine the reading and discussion of a passage with personal sharing. They are, in part, support groups, and in today's fast-paced, depersonalized society, they serve a highly beneficial purpose. I hope that this book will help those who lead or participate in such groups to enhance their experience in them. True professional, historical, critical scholars of the Bible often sniff at these diminutive Bible study clusters because of what the scholars view as the inept and subjective way the texts are sometimes examined. But, as I will try to demonstrate here, the experts and the amateurs have something important to learn from each other. Please note that Bible study is not the same as biblical studies. The small groups just described are what is meant by Bible studies. Biblical studies, on the other hand, is what hit me in seminary, a specialized branch of historical research that scrutinizes the Bible with the same methods used to examine secular texts. Its objective is to learn more and more about such things as when the various books of the Bible were written and by whom, and to uncover what their original sources, audience, and purpose were. It employs grammatical tools, philology, semantic and rhetorical investigation, and comparative analysis. It also draws on archaeology and paleontology, and more recently on the comparative study of cultures. In short, on anything that will bring investigators closer to what a given text originally meant and how it has been interpreted since. What, then, is the relationship between the Bible study that groups do and the biblical studies that researchers do? One of my teachers, the late Christer Stendahl, once said that the two great questions about any Bible passage are, what did it mean then, and what does it mean now? For a number of years, this formula made sense to me. The what did it mean then question obviously fell in the realm of biblical studies. The what does it mean now question belongs to Bible study, preaching, and spiritual formation. This seemed like a reasonable separation of two distinct tasks, but after my short stint in the jail cell and some other experiences that followed, I began to find the bifurcation prescribed by Stendhal's formula no longer credible. The first post-jail experience that shaped my developing view of the Bible came from Latin American liberation theology. This vigorous movement grew from the bottom up, out of thousands of base communities from Guatemala to Chile and from Brazil to Peru, in which ordinary people with little knowledge of biblical studies gathered to share food and sing, but mainly to read the Bible and discuss its significance for their lives. Whenever I sat in on one of these groups, I noticed that, like the black youngsters in the next cell block, these people heard the biblical stories as continuous with their own. They read them not just as literature and not as texts to be analyzed. They read them looking for insights and encouragement in their ongoing campaigns against predatory landlords and corrupt government officials. Their interactions with the Bible were rough and tumble, never merely compliant or saccharine. They were expecting something. Sometimes they disagreed with what they found. I remember a base community in a favela or slum near São Paulo in which the participants were hashing over the account of Jesus' Last Supper with his disciples in Luke. Suddenly, an older man with a weather-beaten face shook his head. "Why in the world," he asked, "did the Lord talk so openly when he suspected there was an informer at the table?" He added that he had had experience with police spies, and he certainly would never have done that. His question might seem naive, but I believe scholars can learn something from the stance these amateurs bring to the Bible. Academically trained biblical researchers often try to distance themselves from any personal stake they might have in what they discover. They think it should have no bearing on their research. They do not want to be considered unscientific, so they sometimes hide any personal investment in their work, even from themselves. They try to take themselves out of the picture. This, at least, was the reigning methodological formula of a previous generation of academic historians, and many biblical scholars emulated them. Now, however, this situation is changing. More and more today, thoughtful historians, including those in biblical studies, know that complete objectivity was never obtainable and was always probably undesirable. It often served as a convenient fiction to mask the personal stake that scholars know they have in their research. Even the most allegedly neutral history always serves some goal outside the scholarly realm, often a political or ecclesiastical purpose. But now, a newer generation of historical critical scholars knows full well that they are not disembodied entities examining a historical event or a biblical book from a fully detached perspective. They cannot get themselves totally out of the picture. This is a positive change. Those of the new generation realize that real knowledge of a historical personage, period, or biblical passage demands the cultivation of a kind of give and take. Also, in doing their work, they are increasingly aware that they are not only writing about, they are also writing for. They have a purpose for doing it. They are human beings with fears and hopes, and they select their topics, direct their research, and frame their writing with some audience and some goal in mind. The result is that objectivity is fading from view, and a candid awareness of one's personal objective is becoming more conscious. The truth is that it is neither possible nor desirable to get oneself completely out of the picture, and this applies especially to anyone who reads and studies the Bible, whether in a living room group or a scholar's library. It is a book that informs our faith communities, our culture, and, whether we like it or not, our own psyches. We carry it under our skins, embedded in our languages and modes of thinking, even before we open it. And when we do open it, we have a genuine stake in what we find. The difference between participants in a base community or Bible study group and scholars is that the lay groups freely acknowledge this realization, while some professionals are still puzzled about how their personal involvement can be reconciled with their scholarly discipline. But they now realize that the quest for total objectivity is dead, and they struggle strenuously with that realization. The study of history has changed radically since I majored in it at college. It was fascinating then, but it is even more fascinating now. I am grateful that this lively conversation among biblical scholars is underway, because as the third, the spiritual phase of my ongoing life with the Bible unfolds, I know that, although my earlier narrative and later historical critical phases were of indispensable value, they had to be incorporated into yet another phase. The key insight I gleaned from listening in on this lively conversation is this: what is meant and what it means cannot really be separated. Whether we are fully aware of it or not, we all go to the Bible looking for something, and what we are looking for is shaped by who we are, how old we are, our class, the racial and gender composition of our society, and even by the temperament of the era in which we live. Young black inmates in a southern prison cell hear the story of Moses and the Pharaoh quite differently from the way the warden does. Impoverished Brazilian peasants read the Sermon on the Mount, with its promise to the poor and its dire warnings to the rich, from a different angle than that of the landowner. Women read those passages in Paul's letters that mandate their silence from a different perspective many men simply do not share. The emerging consensus of this conversation about how to approach the Bible is that we should put aside any pretense of total objectivity as illusory and self-serving. The way ahead is what my colleague Elizabeth Schuchler Fiorenza aptly terms self-conscious relativity. This requires our being quite explicit about where we are coming from and what we hope to find as we read the Bible, and that we expect others to be just as candid. Little about the past reveals itself to a supposedly detached and value-neutral spectator, and this includes biblical passages. Christians claim that God continues to speak to us from the Bible, but the Bible speaks to us only when we come to it with honest questions and real hopes, not as distanced outside observers. On this count, the non-experts who gather in Bible study groups demonstrate an important insight. But members of Bible study groups can also profit from the hard work of people who engage in scholarly biblical studies. Regrettably, just as biblical scholars sometimes sneer at Bible study groups, the people who attend these groups often view biblical scholars as long-winded pedants who make unnecessarily complex interpretations in tomes that are dense and incomprehensible. Unfortunately, the images these two groups of people have of each other have some truth in them. Still, the two groups have something vital to learn from each other. The scholars could pick up hints from the mindset that participants in Bible study groups and base communities bring to the Bible. But these participants ignore, to their disadvantage, the knowledge of the Bible accumulated over the past century by the historical critical researchers. Finding out as best we can where the writer of a particular book of the Bible is coming from and to whom it was addressed are key elements in hearing what the Bible says to us today. Simply stated, it is essential to take the historical dimension seriously. But it is even more important not to get stuck in it. Consequently, I have decided in the words that follow not to describe these technical, historical ways of examining the Bible as critical, even though many of its practitioners do. My reason is that in ordinary language, as opposed to scholarly discourse, the word critical carries unavoidable negative overtones. It often means to disparage or denigrate, but I do not believe that at their best, this is what the historical critical scholars of the Bible intend to do. They want readers to understand the Bible better. My hope in writing this book is to construct a bridge between Bible study and biblical studies in the light of a spiritual approach to the Bible. My objective is to help non-specialists glean from the sometimes intimidating work of biblical scholars' perspectives they can use in their own study of the Bible, and at the same time to encourage professional scholars to appreciate the insights they can gain from Bible study groups. My plan is to discuss several books of the Bible selected in part because they span the entire scripture and in part because of what each one can teach us about how to integrate Bible study with biblical studies. I would add that I believe God's reality is ultimately inexpressible and certainly cannot be captured by our human gender distinctions, so I support current efforts to render hymns and prayers into gender-neutral language. However, to avoid the clumsiness of he-she in citing the words of a biblical text, I will follow the original usage. In this case, I prefer the archaic to the awkward. Here are the biblical books I will discuss, together with the particular mode of historical research each one illustrates. Genesis provides an excellent opportunity to investigate source analysis, the attempt to identify the traditions, written and oral, that were patched together to compile the book. Exodus gives us a chance to learn how the most recent techniques of biblical archaeology augment our understanding of a biblical text. Joshua requires that we learn from narrative theory how to distinguish between history, legend, and saga, and the values of each genre. Job invites us to apply literary theory to the Bible as well as to compare the original with recent fictionalized versions. The prophets can best be understood if we are familiar with form analysis, the study of the external shapes and internal structure of given passages. In reading the Gospels, we will see how what scholars call redaction history, editing, the careful comparison of the Gospels with each other, and translation studies give us a more rounded picture of Jesus and his ministry. To see Paul's letters, which he wrote as he traversed the Roman Empire, in a clearer light, we will use a more recent method called empire studies. Finally, for Revelation, one of the most perplexing parts of the Bible, we will see how the history of canonization, of how and why it is in the Bible, and the history of its use enable us to overcome some of the difficulties it poses. In addition to these research methods, I will also discuss a highly instructive way of reading the Bible that has been especially helpful to me. It is sometimes called the history of interpretation approach. Its thesis is that how people read the Bible in centuries past, from its earliest interpreters to its more recent ones, has something important to tell us about how to read it today. In a way, it enlarges the circle of our Bible study group or of our fellow historical analysts by bringing in people who studied it at different times under different circumstances. It frees us from the tyranny of the present, widens our perspective, and sometimes jars us out of our unexamined assumptions. We can accomplish a similar stretching of our take on the Bible by reading the works of commentators from another culture, gender, or ethnic situation with different life experiences. Underlying the way I call on all the methods of biblical studies discussed in this book is an approach that might be termed dialogical, because it requires us to interact with a biblical passage the way we might with another human being. When we want to get to know a person, perhaps we try at first to find out as much as we can about him or her. But if we really want to get to know the person, we cannot just observe, however intently, disclosing nothing of ourselves. We have to open up. We listen, we speak, we may argue, we may listen again. We try to fathom the way the person thinks. We may test our impressions with others who know the same individual. Most important, if we enter this process in a spirit of dialogue, we must be ready to hear things we do not want to hear, and after listening carefully, to agree or disagree with what we hear a given text saying. The path continues. It does not end. But as we get ready to begin at the beginning, our question is, how do we start down this route? When I answer this for myself, I go back to the three stages of my life with the Bible: the narrative, the historical, and the spiritual. This means that the best way to read any passage in the Bible is to incorporate all three elements. First, never forget that the story is utterly fundamental, even in a letter or a psalm. Ask, what is happening here? Second, become an amateur history detective and uncover the who, when, where, and why about a particular text. Find out something about what people from other eras and other standpoints say about it. I will include some study tips throughout the book to assist with this step. Then move to the spiritual stage. Start to engage the text in a no-holds-barred wrestling match. Listen and be ready to change, but also to argue. Respect the right of the text to say what it says and not what you would like it to say. But don't be cowed by it. Insist on your right to see things differently if you do. This is what I mean by dialogue. And if you open both your mind and your heart to it, the spiritual meaning for today of any text will find its way across the centuries. I guarantee it. Study tips. When reading any book of the Bible, first read it all the way through to follow the storyline, which in many cases is packed with multiple actors and numerous side plots, but which usually has a definite beginning, a middle, and a climax. Next, find out something about where and why this book was first written, by whom and to whom. This is called authorship and provenance. With most biblical books, this step is fairly easy, since countless scholars have been doing the spade work for years. Then consult two or three translations to free yourself from the tyranny of textual literalism. It might even be useful to employ these different translations in the initial reading. Next, find out why this text was included in the Bible at all. For some books, that is not so obvious. The technical term for this is the history of canonization, and I will be introducing some suggestions for finding out about it. Next, look into the way this portion of the Bible has been interpreted in previous generations and the various, often wildly conflicting ways it is being interpreted today, especially by people from different cultures and social strata. Finally, get to the main point. What, if anything, does this book have to say to us today? And exactly who is the us to whom it does or does not speak?
1. Serpents, floods, and the mystery of evil. The Book of Genesis. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was moving over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, one day. Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, Revised Standard Version. In the beginning are the first words of the first book of the Bible. Even though most scholars now agree that Genesis was written and compiled well after some of the other biblical books, there are still good reasons to begin with it. When the rabbis, who initially arranged the order of the books of the Hebrew Bible, placed it first, they knew just what they were doing. Genesis is a collection of stories by four or five different authors assembled by an editor, who may well have added some elements of his own. The book is also a compelling one, packed with action, drama, and a host of lusty characters. Perhaps the rabbi sensed that if readers began with Genesis, they might find it hard to put the rest of the book down. In Genesis, we meet the wily serpent, which Milton thought so captivating that in Paradise Lost, he made him a suave, smooth-talking Don Juan. Here also is Cain, who bludgeoned his brother Abel to death because his own sacrifice was not accepted by God, thus committing the first, but alas, not the last slaying inspired by a religious dispute. Here is the chronicle of Noah and the great flood, the dove, the rainbow, and the embarrassing aftermath of the old man's unzipped drunkenness. Here is the saga of Abraham, the father of faith, a founding figure for Jews, Christians, and Muslims. Here is Jacob, cheating his brother Esau out of his rightful heritage, wrestling all night with an angel, or God, and then courting the lovely Rachel. But most gripping of all, here is the epic of Joseph and his jealous brothers, which Thomas Mann spun out into one of the great novels of the 20th century, Joseph in Egypt. To be unfamiliar with these characters and plots exacts a cost. It makes one an outsider to some of the best literature ever written. In addition to the engaging stories we find in it, there is another reason to begin with Genesis. We are trying in this present book to deepen our appreciation of the Bible by seeing it in the light of modern biblical studies. By stepping into Genesis, we tread on scarred turf over which many hard-fought scholarly battles have been waged, not just fights between literalists, historical critics, and symbolic interpreters, but internal fights within all these camps. And there are still unexploded mines here. I also have a personal reason for starting with Genesis. It was in studying it that I was first introduced to contemporary biblical scholarship and had to cope, given my evangelical background, with how this analytic scalpel first seemed to threaten my own faith, but eventually helped strengthen it. Consequently, my approach here will be to select from the many nuggets Genesis offers some that will best illustrate my basic purpose. Here is how it happened to me. Genesis is a collection of stories by different writers. But when I went to seminary, I had no inkling of such a thing. At that time, however, the multiple source hypothesis, though hardly new, was still regnant. Our Old Testament professor told us all to buy a box of colored pencils so we could draw vertical lines in the margins of our Bibles to mark which parts come from the Yahwist source, blue, which from the priestly source, red, which from the Elohist, yellow, and so forth. These different writers, he explained, can be identified not only by what they call God, Yahweh or Elohim, but also by their different vocabularies, their varying approaches, and even their disparate theologies. The consensus at the time held that the Yahwist source, which is now referred to as J, for the German Yahweh, dates from sometime between 950 and 800 BCE. The Elohist source, E, was said to come from about 100 years later. A third source, called P for priestly, was dated to 150 years after E. In recent studies, all these dates have been sharply contested. I dutifully bought the pencils and drew the lines. I am sure our professor thought this was a useful exercise, and in retrospect, I admit he was probably right. But at the time, it was a little disquieting. I wondered what all this mincing and slicing would do to the voice of Genesis, to its overall narrative, and to its spiritual power. But I also realized that the multiple source theory did help explain why there are different accounts, not just of creation, but also of the flood, God's promise to Abraham, and the moving drama of Hagar and Ishmael. The interweaving of these disparate strands also explains why at times the surface of Genesis exhibits a certain jerky, discontinuous quality. The seams sometimes stick out. Little by little, I decided that recognizing Genesis as the work of many hands did not diminish its spiritual significance. It deepened it. I still have on my shelf that edition of the Bible, with its multi-hued marginal markings, its covers now missing. But I had not been out of school long before another way of studying the Hebrew Scriptures assumed front stage. It was called the narrative approach. Some of its supporters questioned or even rejected the multiple source theory. Others claimed that focusing on it too much, with or without colored pencils, could make one forget that at some point someone put all these pieces together, and that the overall trajectory of the whole edited work was what really mattered. Still others claimed that Genesis had grown by a kind of accumulation process, not by calculated editing and pasting. These newer modes of study were especially favored by people, including some evangelicals, who had always been suspicious of chopping the Bible up, but many others found them sensible too. In my view, it is immensely helpful to be familiar with the sometimes inconsistent sources of Genesis, but also that we enjoy its matchless narratives. Subsequently, the narrative method has been complemented by at least two other approaches. One is derived in part from literary studies, and its proponents call it rhetorical criticism. This means reading a book or passage and asking questions such as, to whom is the writer or editor aiming this text? Who is he or she trying to convince or refute, and why? What is being left out, and why? This is also an especially helpful approach because it enables us to see not only that the different writers of the Bible differed with each other, but also that they argued against each other. Think of Genesis as a kind of panel discussion in which the panelists, drawn in this case from different centuries, present their divergent views on some of the persistent questions of human life, such as guilt, responsibility, death, suffering, jealousy, family tensions, and our relationship to God. In the end, you see that although they differ, their views also overlap, and all of them agree that what they are talking about is of pressing concern. Another recent mode of study is called effect history. It focuses on the question, how has this text been used, applied, or deployed in the centuries since it was written? This method makes sense to many people because it takes seriously the question the average person might well ask about any part of the Bible. What difference has it made? We will see later how this method is especially helpful in studying the last book of the Bible, Revelation. Not everyone needs to master the ins and outs of these tempests among the scriptural literati. The net result is that we cannot only appreciate the Bible as a long conversation, even as a series of ongoing quarrels. We can also view our own reading and studying as a continuation of this conversation. The Bible not only presents multiple points of view, it invites multiple interpretations, and generations of its readers have joined this uninterrupted colloquy. For me, the discovery of the profusion of biblical voices and subsequent interpreters was a welcome one. It still is. In an age of both religious conflict and interfaith dialogue, to find that the Bible itself, beginning with the book of Genesis, fosters a kind of pluralism is refreshing and timely. Indeed, when one looks carefully at the deity described in Genesis, it seems that God smiles on miscellany rather than uniformity in the world. This becomes even clearer when we learn that the Hebrew word most translators have rendered with the word create actually carries a somewhat different significance. The Hebrew term is bara, and it is used in the Bible exclusively for the activity of God. It does not mean to make in the sense of to build or to construct. There is another word for that. Rather, bara has the sense of to order or to assign a place or role. It seems that God's work in creation is to compose a symphony of diverse sounds and tonalities that is intended to be a harmonious whole, complete with counterpoint and minor chords. But unlike the old deist conception of the clockmaker God who constructs an intricate mechanism and then leaves it to run on its own, the biblical image of God is more like that of a composer, director, performer, who constantly rearranges the balance if the trumpets or the bass violins start to drown out the flutes and the violas. Further, he must do so delicately while the orchestra continues to play. To extend the metaphor, in this creation, God enlists the musicians in continuing to compose what still remains an unfinished symphony. Now, with this biblical research in hand, let us begin with In the Beginning. The Creation Stories. As we peruse the familiar accounts of the creation stories, see chapter 1, verse 1 through chapter 2, verse 4a, and chapter 2, verse 4b through verse 31, with the help of what biblical studies have contributed, we immediately recognize important discrepancies among the different strands. And if we consult commentaries, we will also become aware of a large dose of disagreement among competent scholars, not just on what a particular verse means, but even on what it actually says. This variation of opinion starts with the first verse. Although standard English translations render it, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth," most experts on the original Hebrew agree that the word means "in the beginning of God's creating."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.